Dan Miller writes in his book, Wisdom Meets Passion. He tells of growing up in a conservative rural family in Ohio. There was no radio, no TV. Dan found his information in books, and consequently he became an avid reader. However, when he was about 12 years old, something happened that would change his life dramatically. He was introduced to a phonograph recording. You remember the time where records weren't just music, but they'd be people reading or lecturing. It was by a noted motivational speaker by the name of Earl Nightingale. The record was titled The Strangest Secret. And on the recording, Dan Miller heard the gravelly voiced man say that he could be everything he wanted to be. All he had to do was change his thinking. In his recorded talk, Nightingale introduced Miller to six words that he could said could dramatically change a person's lives. And the words were these: we become what we think about. Reflect about that a moment. We become what we think about. I'm not sure that's always true. You know, think back. I remember when I was a teenage boy, all right? Most of what you think about as teenage boys, teenage girls. But I didn't become a teenage girl. But I think there's still a lot to be said for this. Miller recognized that if it were true that we become what we think about, the possibilities of what he could do with his life were suddenly limitless. Mr. Nightingale's secret, of course, was based on a familiar biblical passage. For as a person thinks in his heart, so he is. Proverbs 23:7. Miller was also influenced by a famous preacher. Remember Norman Vincent Peale and his power of positive thinking. So the approach to life was radically different from a more rigid way of thinking in which Dan Miller had been raised. We become what we think about. That meant that he could become more than he ever dreamed if he just thought about the right things. He knew that such radical ideas weren't going to be welcomed in his home. So he hid Earl Nightingale's record under his mattress. And then he'd bring it out at night and hear again the promises of a better life. He says, while his friends were hiding girly magazines under their mattresses, he was hiding Earl Nightingale's message of hope and opportunity. And it captured his imagination as it captured the imaginations of hundreds of thousands of other people over the years. Has something ever captured your imagination? You know, Einstein famously said, imagination is more important than knowledge. And what is imagination? It's a mental picture of something, usually something desirable that could become reality if we do our part. Sometimes it will come to us as a dream or a vision. And oftentimes this dream or this vision is the first step towards a great accomplishment. So here's Jesus embarking on a new ministry, the synagogue in Nazareth. And Jesus is handed the scroll of Isaiah and he rolls it out to the part where he gets to speak out, to tell them what his dream is, what is his mission statement. You know, in Homiletics magazine said, suggests that Jesus' mission is one of disaster relief. And if we're followers of Jesus, that our mission should be disaster relief. For reading from the scroll, he declared that the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, has anointed him, bringing good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captive and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free. For these benighted children of God, his mission is to proclaim good news, announcing the year of God's favor is finally come. It's clear from the gospel record that throughout his ministry, Jesus was guided. Maybe as if he had a spiritual homing beacon that would just direct him right to those in the greatest need of healing and his loving words. Well, news about his powers and compassion quickly spread by word of mouth. And it was not long before there were just crowds of desperate people, harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. They're all flocking to him, as Matthew reported. And yet, even after he became Jesus Christ's superstar, and wherever he went, there were great crowds, his eyes would search through the awestruck multitude. He stopped to talk to the woman who touched the fringe of his robe. He looked up in the tree and saw Zacchaeus the tax collector, keeping away from the angry mob. And we are still guided by Jesus' words today. Reverend Trey Harris of Gonzales, Louisiana, shares. He says, "Not all disaster victims are poor. I was in Katrina. I lived through it. And if it hadn't been for the churches who came and stayed for years, New Orleans would still be a wasteland." Don't get me wrong, he said. "I think the ministry to the poor and infirm and imprisoned is vital, valid ministry for the church and a byproduct of grasping the truth. When Jesus proclaimed his messiahship, Jesus said, The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim that the captives will be released, that the blind will see, that the oppressed will be set free, and that the time for the Lord's favor has come. And he continues to reflect. I think that all of the church does a pretty good job of responding to disaster. We need to improve on our ongoing proclamation of the good news to the disenfranchised, to the generational poor in our inner city neighborhoods and in our rural communities. We could improve our visitation of those incarcerated to proclaim to those prisoners that they can find freedom in Jesus. What a simple, straightforward mission statement, right? Just, we're in the business of disaster relief wherever lives are messed up. You know, in our reading from the Hebrew Bible, we get to see a really great disaster relief worker, Nehemiah. We don't spend a lot of time looking at Nehemiah. But boy, he was driven by his dream, by his vision. The vision that was given by God. And he did accomplish some great things. If you remember, it was nearly 2,500 years ago, the land of Judah was destroyed. Oh, the Babylonians took so many of the people into exile, and the Jews were dispersed across the known world. Jerusalem lay in ruins. It was a dark and desolate time for the people of God. It was at such a time that God planted a dream in the heart of a righteous Jewish man named Nehemiah. My goodness, what a time. There was such a need for disaster relief. You know, Nehemiah, he lived in the capital city of Susa in Persia. Well, we call it Iran now. And Nehemiah was the royal cupbearer to Achish, the king of Persia. Well, you might think the title cupbearer doesn't sound all that impressive. You think, well, what is he, a busboy? But even though it doesn't sound impressive, the cupbearer was an officer of high mark in the royal courts. His duty was to serve drinks to the royal table. You see, there were in all of the cultures and civilizations, the monarchy, the kings and the queens, they were worried about all that court intrigue, that somebody was going to poison them and take their place. So the cupbearer had to be thoroughly trustworthy to hold that position. He must guard against poison in the king's cup, and sometimes would be required to taste first before the cup is given to the king. And the fact that the king trusted him so thoroughly, gave him a position of great influence. So one day, one of Nehemiah's relatives, a man named Hanai, was visiting Nehemiah, and Hanai was familiar with the plight of the Jews in Jerusalem. As he shared with Nehemiah about the poverty and oppression of the people who remain in Jerusalem, and of the despair, the destruction of the sacred city, Nehemiah broke down and wept. He went into a time of mourning and fasting and praying over the plight of the people. And God put it into Nehemiah's heart that he was the one who was going to make this situation right. Well, that's an important thought. You better be careful what you pray for. God might call on you to answer your own prayers. You might be called to carry out God's mission. Well, a dream was born in Nehemiah's heart to go to Jerusalem and help his people. That is how every great work begins. God puts something on a person's heart, and they respond. Nehemiah became committed to the dream God had given him. Nehemiah applied for and received permission from the king to go to Jerusalem. Not only that, he sent him to Jerusalem to be the new governor. Well, he got there, he made a secret inspection. Oh my goodness, the city walls were just completely in ruins. And he resolved that the wall would be rebuilt. Well, as soon as he gets there and he gives his, you know, State of the Union speech as the new governor, there were critics. They were just saying, hey, you can't do it. You know, we have enemies out there, and you start changing the status quo, they're not going to be happy. They're going to come and they're going to stop you and they're going to tear it back down. But Nehemiah would not be defeated. I am doing a great work, he responded to his critics. It cannot come down. What special words. I'm doing a great work and it can't come down. He was up on the wall already starting to rebuild. Nehemiah stuck with the task. Jerusalem was rebuilt. It wasn't easy. Sometimes they had to have their shields while they were working. And, you know, the people were so poor that they were selling themselves or their kids into slavery. And I said, no, that's not right. So the wall was rebuilt. And the poor of the city and the surrounding countryside were given relief from their time of struggle. Well, that's all what's happened so far. And we get to the part of Nehemiah, the 8th chapter that we read today. You know, isn't that a beautiful passage? When the 7th month had come, the children of Israel, many of whom were still scattered in the little towns and villages outside the wall around Jerusalem. gather together in one big group in the square in front of the water gates. And they told Ezra, the scribe, to bring the book of the law of Moses, to read it. Remember, because of the recent history, it's been generations. These folks weren't around when the temple was still standing, when there was a wall, and when they would read from the law. Well, Ezra brought the book of the law and before the assembly, and he read it to them aloud from morning until midday. And the ears of all were attentive to the reading of the book of the law. And he opened the book. They stood. They didn't put out concert CD. That the people stood attentive, as was the custom in biblical times. And Ezra read the sacred writing and blessed the Lord, and the people said, Amen! Amen! They lifted up their hands and they bowed their heads and they worshiped the Lord with their faces facing the ground. Ezra not only read to the people from the law, but he also sought to interpret the words so that the people would understand what was being read. And the Bible tells us that the people began to weep as the law was being read. Can you see in your mind's eye the beautiful event taking place? It's the most moving scene after all the hard work. For all the sacrifice, all the earnest prayers, now in their own city, protected with its wall. They were hearing from their own sacred book, and the tears flowed down from their faces. Now Nehemiah stands to speak to them, and he tells them not to mourn, but to rejoice, for it is the Lord's day, and the rebuilding of the city was the Lord's doing. And Nehemiah reminded them that the joy of the Lord is our strength. What a great day it was for the people of Israel. Maybe this is a great day too. We've come. We've opened up God's Word and heard read. We've been moved to hear what God's saying to us. Just like the folks in the synagogue in Nazareth, and Nehemiah's crowd, and the disciples. Would live out Jesus' mission statement to be disaster workers. So we've heard. We can maybe hear something stirring in our hearts. All that's left to do is go out and do disaster relief. Just to be there where people's lives are messed up, where people are in need, where people need hope and opportunity, that's where we'll be.